Hunger.
Jim Hicks. Rob Hatter. You are now tuned in to the Chop Shop. I'm Retro. Let's get it. We in the Chop Shop. We live in the Chop Shop. We talking sports talk. We live in the Chop Shop. We in the Chop Shop. I'm talking sports talk. So turn your dials up. It's live in the Chop Shop. We in the Chop Shop. We live in the Chop Shop. We talking sports talk. We live in the Chop Shop. We in the Chop Shop. I'm talking sports talk. So turn your dials up. It's live in the Chop Shop. Yeah, it's lit in the Chop Shop. Turn your dials up in the drop top. They ain't based to debate, but they keep it fact straight. Going 30 for 30. Let's do a first take on Facebook Live from 12 to 2. Rob Hatter and Jim Hicks going back and forth like Carter Reyes, Skip Bayless, and Stephen Smith. From on the court, off the court, straight to the field. Not a man of steals, but I made a steal to the octagon where I fight to kill. We go face to face, then you write your wheel. I don't play tennis, but I bring the racket. I'm on the floor, I attack the basket. Put you in the casket when I'm overlapping. Never showing mercy, cause I'm always snapping. Never showing mercy when I'm in the arena. Step into the ring, you see me as I beat him. Step into the court, I'm never backing down. Killing competition, I'm smacking down. Let me get back to the other stuff at the Chop Shop, cause they're cutting up. It's Retro coming to you live to the Chop Shop. Now let's turn it up. Yeah, we in the Chop Shop, man. Shout out to Jim Hicks and Rob Hatter. You can catch the Chop Shop live from 12 to 2 on Facebook Live. Let's get it. We in the Chop Shop. We live in the Chop Shop. We talking sports talk. We live in the Chop Shop. We in the Chop Shop. I'm talking sports talk. So turn your dials up. It's live in the Chop Shop. We in the Chop Shop. We live in the Chop Shop. We talking sports talk. We live in the Chop Shop. We in the Chop Shop. I'm talking sports talk. So turn your dials up. It's live in the Chop Shop.
H-Town! What's up? You know what time it is. It's time for the best 120 minutes of your day. The Chop Shop, the nation's number one urban sports talk show, and also your midday sports happy hour. Yours truly, Robert Hatter, alongside Jim Hicks, coming to you live, broadcasting from Houston, Texas, but we going out all over the world on Facebook Live. We tried both simultaneously today, but we had little technical difficulties, but we're gonna work it out again. Engineers working on it, so we'll be able to go on Chop Shop on Facebook Live and YouTube Live. But guess what I got for y'all? We got a packed day today. Jimmy got his Apple hat on, but I just want to know, y'all. Let me tell y'all something. It took me a half a season, and I got to admit, it done took me a half a season, Jimmy, but I'm ready for a hot take. You know, I don't never get no hot take. I'm about to give a hot take, okay? LeBron James and the Lakers are good at basketball. There you go. I knew you were good. There you go. Hey, let me tell you something. Just come to find down. I'm bringing it this morning, Jimmy. Hey, don't hate on me. But you know what? The Lakers win 120-116 last night over the Nuggets, right? The team that was, a team that's not getting a lot of love but has been, been very good this season. Ain't nobody been talking about the Nuggets that much. You know, the Joker get fat. Then the Joker ain't doing this. You know, back and forth. It took everything the Lakers had, though, Jimmy, last night. LeBron was spectacular. The Lakers, when they go to the All-Star break, reminding us that they're the best and LeBron is lights out. I mean, I just can't. We'll talk about that, but I got one more thing to say, because after we finish basketball, Jimmy, I got to talk about you. Man, what's wrong with your Astros, man? Owner Jim Crane, our opinion is this didn't impact the game. We had a good team. We won the World Series. We'll leave it at that. Are you kidding me? But we're going to go back to LeBron. We're going to go. But, Jimmy, are you kidding me? What's your favorite word? Really? Really? What you got, Jim? What you got, man? Really? Man, get your mute off, man. Hey, really? Hey, man. You and that dog, man. You and that dog.
Now, let me tell you guys, as I said before, in regard to the Astros, you be careful what you wish for. And it seems, I'm going to tell you what it seems like what's going on. You can already feel the momentum from across the nation, the abundance of pushback. And that's how you see, like, you got, it, not necessarily, I'm not going to say it's a collusion, because it's rightfully so to be offended for a lot of the teams. And, of course, I understand a lot of the pitchers as well. Because if you're a pitcher and you were, just say you were a marginal, you were the fourth option, or you were one of those guys that was on the bubble of relief guys, and during the series, your boss used you and you got rocked, that may have cost you a job or hundreds of thousands of dollars in future in a contract extension. So that's what's at stake and why some guys are so bitter. But the media aspect.
But Jim, I want to hear from you, though. I know all that. But someone banged the trash can again. If the Astros PR, they should just be fired, man. The owner was embarrassing this morning. A terrible game plan and strategy, Jimmy, for how you approach a press conference. That's what I'm talking about. It was an absolute clown show. I was embarrassed to be living in Houston.
So Jimmy, what was you expecting them to say?
But Jimmy, come not like that. I would,
so, so you expect them to say, come take the World Series?
No, you didn't hear what I said.
That's a lot of people is asking.
He said, no, he did a lot of good things. Altuve, they should have left him the last. They should have left him where the hell he was. He was terrible. Bregman had some contrite. Bregman was sitting there saying, man, I'm sorry. But Crane had some good points. But Jimmy, when he said it didn't, in fact, let me tell you something. The only thing I could say, because somebody on TV.
Maybe it didn't. That's what he's saying.
Let me tell you something. Something happened this morning. And you know, I hate to look at somebody always sending me something. Talking about, look what this guy said. Somebody said something this morning. And they were talking about, but they used the wrong analogy. They were talking about how the Astros, when they went and played the Bronx Bombers in New York, the Astros beat the Bronx Bombers beat the brakes off the Astros. What scored six runs, eight runs, I guess. But when they get back to Houston, and you help me with this, Jimmy, they don't score but one run. But hold on, we ain't had nothing to do with they batters. Explain that to me, Jimmy. We affected our batters. Not their batters. Why they didn't score but one run when they came back to Houston? Somebody used that analogy, and a very well-respected guy, I don't even think he know what the hell he was saying, because he said...
Stephen A. Smith said that this morning. I mean, on First Take, that part, which you just said. But last month, I mentioned another series for which the Astros, and I gave you guys the stats last month about their productivity on the road versus at home. And I explained to you guys. And then, now, of course.
No, Jimmy, you're missing my point. I want you to help me with this analogy. If the Bronx Bombers score all them points at home, but they come here and can't score no points, we wasn't affecting their batters, were we? Help me. Did that affect their batters? Our pitchers were pitching at their batters. Why they couldn't score but one run a game?
Well, that's on the road.
I understand, but...
I think the last game, it was zero.
But guess what, Jimmy? How did the cheating affect them? Because guess what? They weren't scoring no runs. The cheating was to help us score runs, not to stop them from scoring runs. Are you following me? I'm the only one looking at this that way. The cheating was to help the Astros steal signals, right? So they had some signals to make the hitters from New York not hit good too? I'm asking you.
Hannah, we passed that.
No, I don't. I don't understand it. Coach, you said Stephen A. Smith came on this morning and said the same damn thing. But it...
What part you don't understand?
How did it affect? Okay, let me break it down, because evidently you ain't listening. It's a difference between listening. Hold on, so you can hear me. Don't interrupt, just hear me. How does that affect the bats of the Yankees? Follow me here. Don't whine. Don't pout. How does that affect the bats of the Yankees? The Astros cheating. How does that affect that? That's all I want to know. That's all.
Once again, the Astros tactics that they admitted to breaking the rules this morning has no bearing on any opponent's bats. On any opponent's offense. However, if the score is 0-0, any run that the Astros score, that makes a difference, because at the time, the New York Yankees has the best closer in baseball, Adonis Chapman. So that means if it's a tight run, if Astros up 1-0, I can handle that. But if the Astros up 4-0 as a result of them cheating, then guess what? That makes a difference, because now your whole offensive strategy coming in the late in the seventh to the ninth innings is different as opposed to a one-run game. That's the difference the bearing that it has on an opponent. And so eventually, after a while, you're going to bring guys out the bullpen. You're going to make subs. You're going to make rotations. You're just going to do a lot of things that you would not do different. Certainly, stealing bases. You're going to be more now. Get a run on first. You got to advance that runner now. He's going to get thrown out.
So it affects the whole game.
It affects it.
Okay.
It does.
Okay. I'm glad they got caught then.
So I mean, it's I don't have a problem with now. I caution, understand, the more they squeeze these Astros, the closer you're going to get to possibly one of those guys cracking. What I mean by cracking, just saying and going Nino Brown on this whole situation, say, oh, you know what? To hell with it. I know I played at this other program where I came in. We was cheating over there. I'm just saying, just be careful.
But players have been granted immunity already.
Yeah. The Astros and a lot of the players. And now, did Carlos Beltran get granted immunity?
He was a player at the time.
I'm just saying.
Yes, he was a player. They were talking about that.
So understand. There are some people. Let's say all you have to do is find a disgruntled former employee. There may be this one guy, right, that didn't get interviewed. That didn't get the grant immunity. That might have been.
Hold up. They worked out a deal with the Players Association.
Exactly.
Players.
Exactly.
Granted immunity.
Exactly. So this is my point.
Okay.
I'm the janitor in the room that used to got fired by the old Astro owner at the time, or Jim Crane. I know what was going on, but I'm an old guy. I'm on a fixed income. I come in work and I work during the day or get my retirement. I work some Astros game, which a lot of people I know does it that way. And they work them games in 82 of them a year or 81 of them a year in opposed to their fixed income. That person is the person that may be disgruntled and saying, well, you know what? If they talk to me, I'll let them know what time it is.
I'm talking about the players won't get affected. Once you granted immunity, you granted immunity.
I explained that on yesterday.
Yes.
I explained that part. Understand it. That's why
you talk. So what can this, hold up. So who can this disgruntled employee, the janitor, who can he affect? Not the players. You're talking about the owner?
He can affect the longevity of how long it's been going on. Remember, Justin Verlander.
They got immunity. Jimmy, it ain't going to matter.
Yeah, no. It don't matter for them getting punished.
That's what I'm talking about.
For that sake, it does matter for the whole concept, because you know what happens? When you sign an agreement, don't you know, like that agreement probably say you're willing to tell us the truth? And if you don't tell us the truth, then it voids this agreement. So guess what? If somebody comes out and disputes the accuracy or the longevity or of what one of those guys or more have said already this morning, guess who come out and made a statement already this morning? One of those players who was not part of it. See, here's the thing. Justin Verlander. He was with the Detroit Tigers then, wasn't he?
I guess.
Right? So Justin Verlander came and said this morning, I wish I would have said more. Who is he talking to about? When? This is verbatim. Versus Verlander just came back and
so
said.
So Verlander never won a championship with us?
I wish.
Hold on.
I wish I would have said.
Oh, I got a question. Have he won a championship with us?
I think we got him that year. Didn't we? Got him in 2007.
I'm asking, do he have a championship? Yes, he got a championship.
Because
Detroit ain't won nothing.
Once again, you still ain't listening to what I said. What the hell does that mean to a person? I wish I would have said more.
No, but you said he wasn't on the team then.
Scratch that. He was on the team. I just said we just got him.
Okay.
In 2017. He just said, you're not listening. Let me paint this again. He said this, I wish I would have said more.
And he does, but he's granted immunity because
so what do you think he was talking about?
I don't know. He could have told it. Everybody know they was cheating. Everybody except you, because you were the biggest fan. You didn't pick the cheating up.
Because
you would have said, no, I'm talking about you didn't know it in 17. Dude, you had your popcorn. Dude, you had your peanuts, Jimmy.
Do you understand?
Jimmy.
Not many Astros fans care. That's what I'm saying.
I know y'all don't care.
You don't care. If they can take the ring, we still don't care. You know why? Because everybody, that's what I'm saying to you. If Major League Baseball somehow makes a reversal and an unprecedented move and takes the trophy away, then it's going to be on. That's what I'm saying.
Hey,
that
man.
Means they're going to open up the door and Astros ain't going down by themselves. So they want to stop. Remember, I was playing the pitch yesterday. Carlos Beltran has already been accused of being the initiator, the ringleader of this movement. Carlos Beltran played 3 years before the Astros, he was with the Yankees. 2 years after the Astros, he went to New York.
Wow.
So you think Carlos Beltran, no, I'm sorry. And he only played 1 year, that 2017, with the Astros. 1 year. So you think that Carlos Beltran played with the Yankees and all of a sudden came to Houston and said, you know what, guys? I just thought of something. This is a good way to cheat. We do it like this. This is all we got to do. Then leave the Astros and go back to New York and say, you know what? I ain't going to do it no more. I don't need no advantage no more. You better be careful. I'm just telling them. It's going to be fun because of the fact that these guys are different and they already feel some kind of way about America. You get to pushing, and most of these guys that was on this team that they're interviewing from the islands. Dominican, Puerto Rico.
I don't think they're going to push it.
No, I'm just saying.
Baseball is trying to make this go away. That's all I can say.
Exactly.
They're trying to make this go away.
Because they know this is one scab that you do not want to pull off. Understand? Just like with the juicing. When the juicing era was out, we knew about Mark McGwire and think about how it went back then. We knew. Once you look and they showed us the evidence of how big Sammy Sosa and Barry Bonds had got and versus a couple of years prior. Then we looked at Mark McGwire and how big he was. And you looked at him and then you thought about it. Guess what? At that time, it was funny how this dynamics of this worked back then. Most white folks, that were St. Louis Cardinal fans, they knew Mark McGwire was juicing. Jim, they guess what? They didn't even care.
Jim.
They didn't care.
Jim, I'm just asking. You played baseball. I just played around with it. One of the hardest things I've ever tried to do on this planet was hit a baseball and hit it far. And I'm not no little guy. So you telling me, and I don't believe it. I think the juicing helped recovery. I just never felt the juicing help you hit the ball. Because there's some strong guys can't hit the ball like Barry Bonds. Barry Bonds had some of the greatest hand-eye coordination that I've ever seen of any player. So I'm sitting there saying, I know they're talking about juicing. Yes, it kept them playing longer. I just don't think juicing made them hit over the ball. That's hard to do. Dude, I don't care how big you is and how strong you are. Take your butt to the batting cage. Take your butt right now to the batting cage, y'all. That's the hardest thing. And you got this little old ball coming at you that you can control. You got a guy coming at you shooting that thing 90-some miles an hour with a curve on it. And them guys still knocking them things out of there. That's a lot of skill too, Jimmy.
But understand, what the juicing does, it increases the velocity or the strength of the batter. That's what it did. Of course, guys like Barry Bonds was already a Hall of Fame first ballot without, if you'd cut his career off just when he was in Pittsburgh with the Pirates, he was already Hall of Fame caliber before this era came about. However, it tainted because, once again, just like anything, for some people, you don't know when it started for him. So then it's getting punished. And it's one of those things. You're getting punished.
That's the first thing I heard. That my researchers never told me that. They never told me.
Pull up Barry Bonds on your screen right now. Yeah. Pull up Barry Bonds.
No, I said the people that I know that's in this industry and talk about it, they never said it increased the velocity. Because guess what?
Nah. Dude, increase your strength.
Because guess what? It's some guys taking the same juice that are just control hitters.
Alan, understand.
That's all I'm saying. Some guys were taking the same juice. They still didn't knock the ball out there as much as these guys.
There were four guys that got crucified as a result of the juicing era. It was Mark McGwire. It was Barry Bonds, Sammy Sosa, and Jose Canseco. Mm-hmm. All four of those guys were very, very good as far as hitting the ball already. Now the thing is,
A-Rod, don't leave A-Rod out.
A-Rod got the back after those guys opened the door, and A-Rod, people looked over to A-Rod and like, wait a minute, you used to be little too. Let's watch out. Do you guys understand? A-Rod used to be Derek Jeter's size. Understand?
I mean, that's your theory. I just don't believe that theory.
A-Rod played shortstop before Jeter got there and moved over to third base. Now back to understand. Back to the juicing era with those guys. Those guys, a lot of the fans, a lot of the white population, a lot of people didn't care. They embraced Mark McGwire because it was fun. But then it wasn't fun the minute that Barry Bonds passed up Mark McGwire. But then him and Sammy Sosa had the home run joust that one season when it got up. And so a lot of the Dominicans had embraced, and Chicago fans, okay, which was an arch rival, had embraced Sammy Sosa. A lot of the black people didn't care about Barry Bonds, no juicing. So, we know Barry Bonds was a bad dude. You had all different races.
How did it help Roger Clemens?
Shooting for they got.
How did it help Roger Clemens? Because he was throwing 100 miles an hour at 18 years old.
It helped. No. It helped him at that age, as he got older.
That's what I'm saying.
It helped him keep the velocity, Heather. It helped him keep the velocity.
No, because it helps with your healing. The old people get old. I mean, you. I'm gonna let you go. I'm gonna let you go on that one. because I'm not an expert on. I just talk to the experts, and they said, Rob,
Alan, if you go specify in baseball,
no, I just talk to people. I ain't looking no. I ain't looking no articles. I talk to the people who I forgot what kind of a physicist they are that who talk about that, some kind of the doctor that it's a name for the doctor, but I've talked to several of them and they just tell me, Rob, they think
does that too.
He said it don't help you hit home runs.
It don't help you hit a home run. It helps with your bat. It helps you get stronger. You're stronger and you're healed. What you're saying is absolutely 100% correct. But I'm telling you, in addition to that, you are stronger.
Okay. So everybody taking it should have been stronger.
Everybody should have been stronger.
The whole league.
That don't mean everybody's going to be in the home run derby or in the home run race or in the candidate for that. Everybody.
No, because they can't hit the ball like these guys.
Like they could before without it. They couldn't hit it like them as them.
I'm talking about, let's say, Jimmy, you just wanted an Astro. You been juicing, but you ain't hit the bitch out. Excuse me, you ain't hit the thing out the park yet.
Now, it's going to make me stronger. I'm not going to be able to hit further than Barry Bonds. Do you understand during that year, he was hitting stuff into McCovey Cove, into the pond, Jimmy, out of the stadium.
Jimmy, Ken Griffey Jr. was doing the same thing. Ken Griffey Jr. was hitting and doing the same thing. Did we call him for juicing? That's all I'm saying, man. I'm just going by what I say. I just believe. Robert.
Those guys that we just named, that was those four, they were in the postseason. They were vying for World Series.
Well, guess what?
That's what makes.
We gonna agree to disagree because I'm not gonna believe that. So I'm gonna believe the experts. So I'm not gonna believe that. So what's the next topic? Ain't we got to talk about what that team I was just talking about, the Lakers, on All Star break. LeBron James, and LeBron, do the steroids LeBron take, does it help him hit threes? Because his old buddy's hitting threes. But y'all know what? Oh, I like y'all help me with this with LeBron James. Now, you Brun sexuals, I'm not talking about him. You know, should I put all this accomplishment? I just told you, I like LeBron James. But Jimmy, he had a point blank shot to win the game. He can play the game. He just can't win the game. I'm the only one seeing that. Oh, he's a hell of a player in the end. But, I mean, in the beginning of the game, in the flow of the game, and he'll help you. But I've never seen him. Somebody pull up all the LeBron James buzzer beaters or game winners. Somebody do me a favor. Maybe I'm a prisoner of the moment because it happened last night. I'm just trying to figure out why he can never hit that shot. They wouldn't even have to go into overtime. Jimmy had a point blank shot and missed it. You know, they always said he was he don't have the clutch gene. That was Steve, what's that man name? Skip Bayless. So it's a LeBron getting that vibranium. I mean, hey man, this man, y'all, hold up. This man had, what happened? 32 points, 14, 15, some rebound. I don't know the exact. Jimmy, you the stat guy. Dude, he's a virtuoso now, but he just couldn't close and hit that shot. Okay, Herb says he's a front runner. Okay, all right, a front runner. Jimmy, you must have seen it. You see the end of the game. He could have ended it. He, wallop, wallop. Hold up. The same shots he's been hitting all the game, Jimmy. He couldn't end the game on that same shot. And I'm not trying to talk about it. It irked me a little bit last night, y'all. And I just wanted to know what y'all thought. That's all. You got it, Jim.
Yeah, and I was reading some of the comments on that.
Oh, they're crazy.
And Herb say the guy that gave Aaron Hernandez his steroids lived next to the building, next to his boss down in Miami. And his son attends their school. Wow. But I'm quite sure that he would have one hell of a story on in regards to that. And just reading some of the comments, you guys, and I think it was Lionel Gar. You says you know you don't need to be stronger though. Lionel, I'm gonna give you a link that you can go do some homework with, and there you go right there for you. Now, meanwhile, we got also speaking of basketball last night, Indiana versus Toronto, their 15 game winning streak was snapped last night. And did you guys hear Kyle Lowry them, how easily they accept? It's almost like as if they were waiting and happy that it was over. I mean, really, he was like, you know, man, I'm tired. You know, I'm exhausted. I just found that kind of odd, you know, on that. And that's, I'm just bookmark this moment of February the 12th about the Toronto Raptors, because that didn't, you know, that ain't the way you, I mean, understand, you had to, the streak was going to end. But the way that they accept it is almost as if they are glad that it's over. It's only one game before the All-Star break. You win that game, you go into the break 8 to 10 days, and you are a big man on campus. Now, it's like, okay, you come back, you lose that next game, then it's back to, you know, you're still great. Understand, Toronto, they won 40 games this season.
So what were you saying? Because I stepped out a second. What were you saying about Kyle Lowry?
I don't like the way they accepted their comments after the game. Like, they were almost happy, or not happy, but relieved that the streak had ended. And Jimmy, I just didn't. Jimmy. I didn't like that.
You don't have to like it, Jimmy. See, sometimes when these guys tell the truth, y'all don't like it. Maybe he should have just did the Jimmy. That stuff. They make this break around the same time. Dude, every dude I've talked to in the league, even the losers, Jimmy, they tired. They mentally tired. Their bodies don't have a whole day of rest. So now, yes, he tired. I've heard that a million times, but not they haven't said it on TV. But
exactly.
I mean, dude, they tired. LeBron was tired. You should have saw how he walked off the floor last night. He was like, man, let me get to this dress room, get on this plane. Man, let me get the heck out of here. I mean, it's rough, but he didn't say nothing about it. You just had a problem with him verbalizing, I guess.
Yeah, and of course, also, Indiana, I mentioned a while ago, they picked up a good win over Milwaukee without the Greek Freak. Understand, Greek Freak, in case you didn't know, guys, he's a father now, for the first time. So he's earned the right.
Oh, he didn't play last night?
No. Okay. He didn't play none the last two or three games. Okay. He's been out.
Okay.
And so but he's earned that right. Nobody there, based on his first half of the season of, you know, we approaching the 50 game mark, 55 game mark for a lot of teams. So that means you're almost right at two thirds of the way home. So he gave him an extra week off, basically. Briefly to be with your family. Because All-Star festivities, he's going to be in high demand, interviews here, playing in the game, doing all type of stuff. And then a lot of guys during All-Star break, in case you guys didn't know, that's when a lot of the pros who have endorsements, this is when they film a lot of their upcoming stuff for quarters to come, for the second quarter, third quarter, fourth quarter. They do a lot of their obligations during that time, especially the collaborated guys. Well, say like when you saw those State Farm commercials and then you had Chris Paul and Paul Joe, different guys.
Do you know who hooked Chris Paul up with State Farm?
No, I didn't ask him.
Steve Stout, that guy. He the one hooked that up. You know, because he's in corporate America. He bridged that gap. That's just a tidbit for y'all. Steve Stout, y'all can go Google it, but keep going. But Jimmy, what I'm talking about, you know, on the winning streak, always remember, when you have streaks like this, you have more demands on your time, just like you just said. When they have streaks like this, you got more reporters, more everything. And you got to remember, they got Canadian reporters and American reporters condescending, converging on them. So That's what that guy was saying. Man, I'm glad this mess. I don't want to talk to nobody else. And then if you talk to the Canadian reporters, Jimmy, guess what? The British, because it's a province of over in the UK, the British reporters want a piece of you. So that's the, when you're playing those international teams like that and you're winning, and you the reigning champion, yeah, that boy tired. And guess what? He ain't going to get no rest. Because soon as he get off that plane today, it's obligations. Obligations.
Oh, absolutely.
And he going from cold to cold. So, yeah, so it's, that's all. I just wanted to share that with y'all. I kind of know what these guys be going through. I've seen it firsthand. So what else we got?
Oh, man, I'm trying to think what else happened last night in basketball, in the basketball world. Damian Lillard got hurt, and now he's going to be replaced by Devin Booker.
All that whining he did, yeah.
In the three-point and the skills competition. The three-point shootout and the game, Devin Booker.
Yeah.
I'm not mad at Devin Booker getting in.
Who you want?
But I really thought that it would have been cool for the NBA to find a way to honorary, because they've done it in the past couple of years.
Vince Carter.
To insert Vince into this game as an honorary member. I mean, and the reason is because of his contributions, not to compare him to a Dirk Nowitzki or Dwayne Wade, whom they done it for most recently, but for his contributions and him and still being filled with basketball life at 42, 43.
Think about that. Why didn't he?
That's, I haven't gotten that answer. I mean, of course, somebody's going to get asked that question this over the weekend as to why. But you know what? If it could have happened, and all it would have taken was for some of his peers to make a verbal push, and that it is shown in recent years that the NBA players, once they want something,
they can get it done.
People listen.
Chris Paul didn't want him in there.
I'm just saying, but they would have collectively.
Paul wanted him in there. He would have been in there if it was possible.
Chris Paul didn't want him in there, so it took more. It could have came from another angle. Hell, the Greek Freak could have said it. You know, I'm just saying it could have came from another angle.
LeBron James, the president of the Players Association.
LeBron James could have. I'm just saying a social. LeBron James ain't president of the Players Association.
Former vice president.
He ain't. That ain't president.
Once you're vice president, you're vice president for life.
Once you loved, Steph Curry could have made a promo. I'm just saying, people
Vince has been a great ambassador for the game.
Exactly. So, and it could, and that's the thing. So to not do it, knowing that this is his last year.
But what if he's not? What if he's going to stay another year?
I mean, he's, you know, I mean, he can now. Maybe they'll add him to the All-Star game.
Man, the All-Star game ain't that great for him to be in. I mean,
it's not a thing. But sometimes guys want to go out, like, you know, give me my flowers while I'm living.
I got something for the ladies, Jimmy. Jennifer Hudson is going to pay a tribute to Kobe at the All-Star game. Jennifer Hudson going to be singing. I don't know what time. It may be before the game. She is going to pay a tribute to Kobe Bryant at the All-Star game. Unbelievable.
Well, J-Hub, it's about time to see her again. She's been laying low, raising her family and everything, and that's been a great thing for the
college. Excuse me. A fellow Academy Award winner. A fellow Academy Award winner. You know, she won Academy Award, I think, in Dreamgirls, Best Supporting Actress.
Yeah.
Yes. So, hey. Yeah, I like that. I like that.
And who was that? Somebody, Corey Wendleton, You ask on the in the Boomer Room, has Vince Carter announced his retirement?
I'm not sure.
Yes, he has. Mm-hmm. Vince Carter said it on national TV last summer. Okay. He said that this is his last season. And so this was back what's the show that comes on during the middle of the day that Tracy McGrady is on now?
The Jump.
He was on The Jump. And he has said that. He was in there. Remember him and Tracy McGrady, T-Mac are cousins. And so that was but yes, he has basically said that. Now I don't know the formalities of how it's formally done with the NBA or the Players Association, but he said it out of his mouth. So anyway, that's OV. And now last night also something happened, shifting gears and going over to the NCAA ranks.
What they doing over there?
University of Houston got another win. It was a hard fought win. But Quentin Grimes is officially back in the starting lineup for the Cougars, and he scored 22 points, 9 of them in the final 3.5 minutes to propel the Cougars to the win. So once again, Quentin Grimes, 22 points, and the W over South Florida. South Florida, man, they had a sub-500 record.
I don't care, as long as the kid playing. Because if he didn't, he should have did it on Florida. I take every victory, every small victory, I'll take it.
In this game, the young man who returned from the one-game suspension, what's his name, Giroux, he came off the bench. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of like part of you got suspended a game, bring you back and let you work your way and re-earn your starting lineup, your starting spot. Quentin Grimes is inserted back into the starting lineup. I think he played something like 35 minutes last night. But Giroux was in foul trouble most of the way, chasing fouls. And so he only played about 15 minutes, guys. Quentin Grimes played about 35 minutes. And they were able to pull through. How about Fabian White? Had 10 points. Chris Harris played damn near 30 minutes. That may be his season high for minutes played for Chris Harris. I don't think that the Cougars, I'm not looking at the box, I don't think the Cougars might have played no more than two guys off the bench more than like 5 minutes. They went. Cedric Adler didn't touch the court last night. Yeah.
I don't mind. He always gonna be my MVP. But I don't care what team it is. I am so glad, man. Jimmy, they were on the road. See, this is what people don't understand. Well, you always say it, but you have selective. It's hard to go on the road. It's hard to go on the road. We've already established that Quentin Grimes is not that dude they expected. He ain't that Quentin Grimes no more. He's the regular Quentin Grimes now. So that 22 points, let me tell you something. I take my hat, Q Grimes. You notice, I don't care what they say about you on this show. Man, you're all right with me, man. Keep plugging away from it. Because guess what? I was at a game. And somebody who watched this and watch y'all for a living said, it's going to just take a little more time with you. Just keep plugging and keep better. Keep being better. Okay? You will have a chance to play this thing after your college career. Just keep plugging, sir. Keep plugging. Shout out to him.
Adam, every team in the top 20 mm-hmm. in the country mm-hmm. has a vast amount of players who have a chance mm-hmm. to play beyond college. Mm-hmm. Now, I mean, so you say that's natural nowadays.
But this wasn't no overseas guy. It was an NBA guy told me this.
having a chance mm-hmm. and
everybody actually, don't have a chance.
Now, let me tell you something. Come on now. Stop.
Jimmy.
Stop. When you,
Jimmy,
hold on.
Jimmy, oh, today, I got a question. Who else on that team got a chance?
Huh?
Who else on that team got a chance?
You saying got a chance?
Yeah, who else on that team got a chance?
Giroux definitely has a chance.
What'd you just say? He was coming wet off the wet?
Dude, that was part of punishment.
He was benched early in the season, Jimmy, for performance. Early in the season, he was benched.
and he's been the guy with the ball in
early
his hand.
In this season, he was benched.
Each of the last few games before.
I'm so glad you ain't no NBA scout. Thank you, Jesus.
He's the guy with the ball in his hands. He's the guy playing so-called point guard for the Cougars. The majority of the time he's on the court.
I would have felt better if you said Caleb Mills. I'd have felt better.
Dude.
I just felt better.
First of all,
Rice got anybody on that team?
You mixing milk and water. When you're a McDonald's All-American in today's
Jimmy, stop.
You expected to be not
you
just
You weren't listening to me. I said, throw all of that out the window. He ain't that guy no more.
No. That's where I'm at. Don't try to. So now we try to race the chalkboard.
You don't follow him too much after high school. I thought you was the high school basketball guru.
If they winning, I do. I'm following the Cougars, and they're winning. Top 25 three years in a row. First place in the American Conference. All alone. In a 3-4 bid conference, they're in first place up. This is not the Southland that we're talking about, or the Sun Belt, or the Conference USA. This is a 3-4 bid conference. Easy. And so the thing is now, once again, he's did well in the game last night, in a win, in the confines of the team. And so now at the same time, and I see Stacey, you're saying you're starting to want to Stacey. I'm not a huge fan. I don't have to be a huge fan of Quentin Grimes. There are certain guys when you watch on TV every day, you know they ain't certain fans of certain guys. So that means you already know that. So guys, understand. But I have valid reasons.
But I like the kid.
No, understand.
I admire the kid.
I have valid reason that to not be a fan. Remember that now. That goes back to his high school days. And how do you know that? So therefore, you know doggone well I got, yeah.
I'm not listening. That. Yeah. I'm not listening to you right now.
So I can refresh you guys and give you the story again.
I'm not listening to you right now.
So understand. Therefore, once you understand that, like Stacey, then guess what? You got to be, you said, I got to be mad about something. You damn right I was mad about it. I'm not mad about it.
Hey, man, don't go there today. Stacey, leave him alone.
But it's a valid reason.
I'm finna mute Stacey.
A very valid reason.
Stacey, I'm about to mute you.
Remember, Stacey, if you ever get into a situation where you have, when a person goes out of their way to not support you, then you're not going to go out of your way to support them. That's just life. That guy's an adult. Y'all want him to be kids. If his ass go commit a crime tomorrow, guess what he's going to be tried as? An adult. That's just life. That's why, one of the reasons why I explain to you guys, when them guys leave and you guys don't normally see me out, I don't have much to do with them once they leave high school. But I'm still going to look and pay attention.
I got something for you. I'm out on the screen, but you can hear me. Hold on now. You just call him a grown man now. But when whatever happened, he wasn't a grown man. He was a high school kid. Because you have high school kids. So it carries on. You got a carryover. You carry. You know, you remember they used to have Jimmy, they don't have a carryover plan no more. Yeah. They got unlimited. You're supposed to have unlimited love now. You shouldn't carry that over, Jimmy.
Shooting at the whole house. The whole house. That's you guys understand it. That's part of being first team all petty.
Oh, that's right. My bad.
That's part of being. I got to keep reminding you guys every day.
Yeah. Because I have faith. You know why? Because you remember you told me the analogy. If you put a drunk and a preacher in the same room, one of them going to come. I'm hoping you in the room with me, man. I'm hoping you get better. I'm hoping and praying that you get the pettiness. I pray.
Hannah, if you put the drunk in the room with the preacher, and I'm in the room with me, and you want to declare yourself as the preacher, You, if you ain't got no water, I'm going to be over in the corner using my old skills and making a big bag of hooch. And you're going to get thirsty. You're going to drink some of that hooch
hold
with
on,
me.
Hold on. I disagree. You have got better in areas.
Absolutely.
So guess what? The preacher, I'm converting. I can't convert you all the way. But I'm chiseling it away at you, buddy. I got some more prayer to do. Yeah, hey, I promise you. Y'all, when I go up, and you know, because they ask for prayer every Sunday, I promise you, him and Sandra is in my prayers. I got to. He on my show. I got to make sure he all right and his wife all right. So guess what? I'm chiseling away. I got a chisel. Clack up, clack up. I'm chiseling away at him. So what's the next one, man? What else we got? Because you remember, I got to tell y'all this story about the NFL.
Now, of course, we're on the back nine already. And speaking of college ball, we get the last updates. SMU, of course, Kendrick Davis, 19 points in their win over UConn.
I like him, man.
And also, Auburn picked up a super win last night, overtime. Do you realize Auburn has went, like, last four of their five games was overtime wins?
Yeah.
Ooh, man. And one thing about Auburn, the reason I brought them up is, this is something that I'm really, and you guys can help send me some intel on kids that you know. When I say kids, meaning, you know, that's an analogy like we use soda water. We call it soda water, Coke. We just call them, if you're younger than me, you're a kid. But former ball players who went to college at the Division I level, because it's easier to track than non-Division I, easier to verify. That were walk-ons and ended up playing, getting a scholarship before they graduated. You follow me? In other words, players that you may know from the state of Texas in the past 10 years, to keep it safe, since 2010, that went to Division I basketball program. We're talking hoops now. That were walk-ons when they got there and ended up on scholarship before they graduated. I want to find and comprise a list of those, because that's the, and I want to do something with that at the, you know, when I come up to the next magazine at the end, towards the end of the year. And the reason is that because the kid that, you're right, Rodney, that you're stealing some of my thunder, Justin McCormick, he was a star and a starter for Auburn. He was a walk-on from Maid Creek High School. You guys know what Coach Favre coaches at now? He wasn't there then. Favre is just on his second year at Maid Creek. But Justin McCormick was at Maid Creek High School. And this kid went and walked on at Auburn. And that's the whole thing. That doesn't mean he was good enough for Auburn when he went there as a walk-on. It just go, because a lot of kids get better. And then some people that don't want to acknowledge and don't want to chalk it up as people getting better, because they'll make it seem like he was already that good 4 years ago. No, he wasn't. But at the same time, he took a leap on faith. And I want to do something to acknowledge a lot of the young men. And I would love to have that list of people. Of course, we knew Otis Lanier, say Quentin Thomas, he walked in, but that's way before 2010. Otis Lanier, Quentin Thomas, I think that's Danny Thomas' son, played at Humble High School back in the days and walked on at LSU. Yes. If I'm not mistaken, I think that's Danny Thomas. He used to be the assistant coach at Cashmere. He's now the assistant coach at Milby High School. Danny could shoot that rock back in the days. Played in the pro-am back in the early 80s, all the way on through that decade. But there's other kids. Chris Collins went to Friendswood, walked on. Tyreek Armstrong, who's a starting point guard at TSU, he was a walk-on. He's on scholarship, I think, now. Faith Williams over at Prairie View with Byron Smith, he was a walk-on. He doesn't start, but he plays starter minutes. And I'm just naming a couple off the top of the head, but I want Wes Van Beck from Westside High School back in like 2013. He walked on at U of H, and they gave him a scholarship on the thing and went viral with it. You know, a lot of kids don't really know when they're going to get that announcement and the team goes berserk. But Yes, Trey Phillips and Derek Austin is another one. Over at Boise State, balling this right now. He was a Spade Jesuit and walked on at Boise State. And now look, was he that good then? No. He wasn't as good as he is now. Nobody is supposed to be in any sport. It's supposed to be they're still young and have most of their career in front of them to be as good as they are today than they will be 4 years ago from now. So he got better and it was a great move. But at the same time, it takes economics or academics to even be in a position to do that. One of the two, ain't no middle ground for being that walk on, especially out of state. Because you're thinking about out of state tuition in most cases and whatnot. But that was something I didn't know Wes was on the staff. Thank you, Friedman. Wes is on the staff at U of H. Wow. And Rodney says McCormick has the school assist record at Auburn. I didn't know. I mean, appreciate that tip. Man, I mean, a lot of guys, one thing about it, a lot of guys from Texas, not just, you know, we just mentioned in Houston, but I really would love a list from around the state. You guys in DFW, I see Stacy is on the feed right now. Let us know some of those guys that walked on. Just walked on. Especially the black guys. Especially those. Because there's been a myth that normally the black walk on is not going to be as, it's not going to take that role as easy as the white walk on. There's no easy way to put it. And I'm telling you, that comes from the other side of the fence, from the college coaches. And it may be true, but I still want to know the disparity and want to just see, because we not just named about four black guys that walked on and they are having some hella success. So that was the thing. And guys, don't forget, it's that time, almost time for the mailbag. We go up in that mailbag and get some of your questions and address them. If you got some, you can email them to us real quick at Chop Shop.
I saw some. Somebody sent me a video. And I am, and other people, I just want, because I've never seen this young man play in person. Somebody sent me a 9-minute video, and I watched 9 minutes of it. So people on the line, Facebook, on Facebook, please tell me, have you seen the kid, Sir Isaac Heron, play? I know with Jimmy, I talked to Jimmy about him. I know he saw him once or twice. I don't know how many times he's seen him. I've never seen him play, but I just couldn't believe what I saw on video. And I know, you know, and guess what? I'm not a college coach, so I can get excited about certain things. I might not know what he can't do, but I saw some stuff that he could do, and I said, wait a minute. So Friday, I don't know. It's just going to be hard. According to what time? They play at 5:30 on Friday. I'm going to try to make it to their game. They play on West Side, but I just want to see him play. And I just wanted to know if anybody's seen him play. You know, just let me know. I just want to know your opinion of him. Because that 9-minute video, man, it had me want to call his mama.
Understand, the thing is consistency, and that's from everybody. Just there, Tuesday night, Lamar High School played Sam Houston,
okay,
in a key pivotal district showdown, meaning that it was pivotal because Sam Houston and Lamar was in second place. Sam Houston was in third place, so Sam Houston won the game, and it's not slight to any of the kid, but then those are the type of games that you would want that magnifying, dominating performance, you know. And I know that I think the big fella had 11 points in that loss, and the coach sent me the score sheets after the game, and so shout out to Coach Barreras. He always sends score sheets to me, and I look at them. And especially games like that, I don't get ask one for all of them. But Sir Isaac is a talented young man. I watched him play twice this season. He's about 6'8". He's doing a lot facing the basket this year.
That's what I like about it.
So the thing is, you know, if the shot's going to go, he's kind of in the mold of a Royce Ham, where he was. He's more athletic, but he's in that mold. Remember, Royce Ham was a four that was turning into the three and had, it was right there iffy if he could go and make the transition at the next level to be able to be the three, or they were going to put him at the four, or he'd be fighting it and be neither one.
I never saw Royce Ham in high school. So what school did he play at, Royce Ham?
At Davis.
Yeah, I never watched him play. I never saw him play. But I'm just interested. I'm going to go see him. I just want to see him. Because I just saw so much the fluidity. I mean, he bringing the ball up. He hitting the deep three. I said, whoa, 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 whoa. But he just probably not. But guess what? Somebody told me he hadn't been playing basketball that long. Jimmy, that can attribute to the inconsistencies because basketball is one of the – you remember I told you about hitting baseball? Playing basketball at a fast pace and the right way and thinking on your feet, not traveling. You got to think of all this going fast pace back and forth, no huddle like the football after every basketball. People don't understand. It's a hard game to grasp. You know, especially when you ain't played it when you was a little boy. You know. So I mean, I'm interested. I just want to see him play again. I mean, I've never seen him play. I wanted to see him play.
And you know, and that's, of course, Herb say he tracked the box. The score she had him with 11. He had 14. You know, 11, 14. But he was playing against Sanu, right?
What did Sanu have that night?
Sanu didn't have about I want to say, like five, something like that. Sanu doesn't do a whole lot offensively in that system. That's why I'd say a lot of times, when people do the same thing, they're going to see Big John Sanu. And, you know, you don't even expect much from him offensively because in that offense, there's no accountability for some offensive, especially because he's not facing the basket well out there. He's down on the block. And there's no accountability for those guys to make sure they get him a touch early on. As opposed to Sir Isaac, he's going to be on that wing. He's going to be one of those guys that's going to get an early touch. And if open, he's going to shoot the three. Okay. And if it goes in, and it looks real sexy. And then now it spikes him up. Some kids, this is a key summer for Sir Isaac because he can go and he will be playing on the 17 on the sneaker circuit.
Where are you playing?
He's playing on the Under Armour circuit.
Okay.
But depending on what he does will dictate his the future.
Okay.
And he's going to
ain't really no big thing. I couldn't believe he was doing all this. I said, what the hell? I want to see him with my own eyes.
I mean, of course, we all do. Doing it while you're guarded by a 6'8".
Well, he ain't going to be doing it. Oh, Westside got a big dude, but
he ain't going to go away like that.
No. Yeah, you're right.
You see? You're not going to go chase him out there to the three-point line.
Okay. I was going to make it a point of having unsung guys that I haven't really just heard about that much. And I just want to, you know, because you do this all the time. I'm just trying to have it where, you know, I can, so I can have something to talk about when I'm on the show with you. But Sir Isaac Heron, I'm going to see him Friday. What else we got?
Yeah, so what else we got? I see Angela Holcomb has joined us on the feed. And I see, shout out to Frank Young is on the feed and Stephen Woods is on there. Head coach Stephen Wood, the champ, is in the house.
Yes, sir.
My favorite coach. Also, guys, don't forget the district standings have been updated on rcssports.com. So you can go there and print you a copy of the district standings. That way you have going into the games this weekend. The last week of the high schools, the public high school season is approaching and it would, a lot of the teams in public schools will end their season next week. Now, as for the private schools, a lot of the private schools end their season this week. And the SPC, that's the district, I mean, the association that includes Episcopal, Kincaid, St. John's, Houston Christian, and those guys, they have ended their season last week. They will be playing, starting tomorrow, their version of the state championship. The SPC championships takes place this weekend. And I think I said tomorrow. It starts today. Sorry, stand corrected. It starts today. And Kincaid plays Trinity Valley at 5:30. That's at Greenhill Phillips School. That will be followed by St. John's playing the Oak Ridge School. Not Oak Ridge out of Conroe. It's the Oak Ridge Private School. That will be at 7 o'clock at Greenhill Phillips. There's a doubleheader there. There's another doubleheader at Cistercian High School, and that will be Houston Christian versus Episcopal School of Dallas. Now, Houston Episcopal has a bye because they were deemed the champion after beating Houston Christian last week. They will play the winner of Green Hill and St. Andrews, who will play at this evening at 5 p.m. I'm part of the doubleheader before Houston Christian. So shout out to all of the teams up there. Special shout to the Houston area teams. All four of them have a chance to meet each other in the semifinals of this rendition of the state championship. Now, meanwhile, I want to remind you also this weekend, the Guy V. Lewis Award, with the 10 finalists will be announced Saturday, 6 p.m. on the Cube 57. So Todd Freed and myself have a special segment dedicated to the announcement of the 10 finalists for the Guy V. Lewis Award. This Guy V. Lewis Award has been established since 2012. I think Rashid Suleiman was the winner, the recipient that year. I think it was Rashid Suleiman. 2013 was Aaron Harrison. 2014 was Justice Winslow. 2015 was Galen Rock. I think it was Galen Robinson and De'Aaron Fox. I don't know which order they came in, 15 and 16. And can't remember who was 17. And Quentin Grimes was 18, 2018, I mean. And last year, the winner in 2019, who won it last year? Can't remember. I can't remember who won it last year. Kyrie McDaniel. Remember that was the first time.
Kyrie, my man. Yeah.
The first time that a kid that, you know, went to and gave it to the People's Champ, based on him leading Klein Forest to the state tournament and the phenomenal season that they had, and it was a way to just give one. Because remember, Xavier Wheeler would have been the favorite. He didn't play enough games. He didn't play the amount of required games. Xavier had sit out the whole year. And then Stretch Campbell, his team had an early exit. So it was kind of like a lot of guys got eliminated because it's a high school. It's, you know, basically you got to get something done in the postseason for this award. Not necessarily get the state, but at least get something done. Now, speaking of the Guy V. Lewis Award.
Look at you, Jimmy. Understand? People got their finalists already on the page.
10?
Huh?
Are they naming the winner or are they naming the 10?
They finalists. You know, they finalists.
Yeah,
like,
okay.
Rodney Richard said, he going with Griggs, Long, Cryer, Jones from Yates. No way. What about my man from Lamar?
Jordan Ivy Curry?
Yeah.
Oh, he should make the – I mean, it's possible. I mean – I don't see a reason why he shouldn't be in the 10 list based on that season that he's had this year. And want to remind you guys, speaking of down that way, on Tuesday night, Texas City played Santa Fe. You guys remember Santa Fe is the school that had the tragic shooting about two or three years ago. Remember all of the kids got shot at the school and it was a tragic thing. And the young man who was trying to he hadn't went to trial yet for that horrific incident. Well, Texas City, who's in first place in their district, Santa Fe, who's like almost in last place in their district. Matter of fact, they were winless in their district, 0-11 at the time. Toward the end of the game, two players got locked up with their arms, and it resulted in a bench clearing
brawl
situation. People from the stands. And so, depending on what side of the fence you hear, and then that, so on social media, this is why I tell you guys to go. I'm gonna lead this back to the point that Hatta has been hitting on his nail for this week and last week. On social media, some of the supporters of Santa Fe High School took to social media and claimed that the Texas City, some of their spectators or people that was involved or in earsight had made some racial remarks towards the Santa Fe people. Saw it as quote unquote black power. Let me tell you something, guys. In the middle of a squabble, I don't know many black people that's going to step in the middle of, I'm squabbling with a white, I'm verbally squabbling with somebody white. I don't know. It ain't just in our genes to just stop in the middle of the squabble and holler at black power. So I didn't really believe it. I spoke with the coach of Texas City. I wasn't able to get in touch with the coach of Santa Fe, but luckily Texas City has video or had footage of what happened. And that possibly saved the coach from Texas City from getting suspended. You know, as a hearsay, or his kids. Now, don't get it twisted. Some kids are going to definitely get suspended as a result of leaving the bench because that's part of the rule. If you get ejected, then you automatically have to sit out the next game. That's a UIL rule. So there were some at least three or four ejections. But the thing is, I was telling Coach that the people in Santa Fe beat you, tried to create their own narrative. And they ran to social media and done so. I say, you have an avenue that your people, you don't have to do it, Coach. You don't put yourself out there. But some of your people, one of your parents, you can let them know, hey, yo, contact the chop shop. We're going to get there. We're going to smoke. We're gonna put water on this stuff already. In other words, they tried to make the Texas City fans to portray them as like violent animals. And if you let them get to the keyboard before you do or get to your narrative, that's what they do. Now you got to go and play defense and go just to make people not believe that is that, man, that's not true. Nevertheless, what really happened? Guys, pay attention. You use your avenues to your advantage. Another thing happened. Remember the other day, Hatta told you that I put some on there about in the VIP news at rcssports.com. You guys will love that if you hadn't been there yet. It's a lot of what's going on and what's happening around Greater Houston in basketball. Well, there was a job at a new school that opened up, and I mentioned
Jordan High School,
Katie. Jordan High School. That's not named after Michael Jordan. For those that don't live in Houston, you could best believe Katie ain't naming nothing after Michael.
What about Barbara Jordan?
It ain't named after Barbara Jordan either. You could best believe that. It's named after Jordan. It's a family that was a wealthy family that long lived in Katy. This guy was a homesteader and a farmer back in the days, and his family is generational wealth. They've been longtime donors and supporters of KDISD. I think as it stands right now, some of the great grandchildren, according to, there's 11, approximately 11 family members from the Jordan family tree that are educators in KDISD right now. That family, that school is named after him. Now, I got pretty much contacted by pretty much every coach that had the interview after I posted on the website. Nobody denied it. They knew that was poetry. It's like, but I made life hard for a lot of those coaches. And I wasn't trying to do that. Meaning made it hard, meaning that it's the middle of basketball season. And those guys had interviews. During the last round of interviews, it was four guys at least. Once I posted it, that means a lot of those parents became abreast, right, that think about it like this. You're going into the playoffs. You're in the playoff run. And you find out as a parent that your coach is trying to get another job and your kid is in the 10th or 11th grade or even the 9th grade. You see, some parents feel some kind of way. That's a lot of stress. Now that coach got to answer questions. Where you going, coach? And don't let the kids find out because you don't really want the kids to know unless you get the job.
They didn't come there because of the coach?
A lot of them do.
No, they're zoned in them schools.
Yeah, but you...
And then you ain't coming there because of no coach. So why you worry about the coach for? Some of y'all can't play.
Hell, there are some kids that go to them schools when they're in the 9th grade and you got open enrollment in certain districts. You can go to certain schools.
For the coach.
You just can't play varsity that first year. A lot of those guys ain't playing varsity anyway. A lot of it happened.
Well, they need to be mad then.
But that's what I understand. So this is one of the things that I put out. And I spoke to them. I was upset or disappointed at the fact that KDISD would actually conduct interviews for a basketball job a week before the season ends. With most of those coaches were in the midst of playoff runs or in the midst of jockeying for their playoff position. So I'm like, well, you couldn't wait an extra week to do this? That school doesn't open one extra week. You couldn't wait to do that then? So now, if Katie, that means one day, each one of those four or five high school coaches had to conduct the practice, had to leave and tell their boss, if their boss didn't even know or not. That's another thing. Because did they get permission from do they get permission from the AD to, hey, man, I want to talk to one of your coaches? Or the principal? I don't know. Did they? But that coach left practice or left school and went on the interview. Then you come back to your kids like ain't nothing wrong. You see?
I don't see. I understand. Huh? I understand. Man, them kids, man, it's high school basketball, man. It's high school basketball. I mean, it's high school basketball. Of course, if that man want to interview, that's his job. To go interview.
So why do you want to hide it? Why you don't want it published?
Well, because then people start running their mouth about it. Everything, I don't want everybody talking about. Everything in my life. That's why I tell them people, don't put your business on social media. And then tell people to not talk about it. You know what I tell them, Jimmy? Man, I'm in season 4, episode 5 of your bull crap. I've been listening to this mess. So guess what? Of course we'll talk about it. He might have didn't want nobody to know. It's all right. You don't tell people everything. When did that happen? When did that happen?
It's not telling people everything. But if that's supposed to be a secret, why should that be that big of a secret? Here's the thing. So yesterday, in the Beaumont newspaper, there's a writer, right? that, and I'm gonna get you the right. I always like to quote, like the source. You know, I really do. And this is gonna be fun. I mean, I'm pulling this up for you guys, right? This young man down in Beaumont, his name is Jorge Ramos for the Beaumont Enterprise. The football coach at Beaumont United resigned after 2 years. The school has only been in varsity for a couple of years. He resigned. So that job is open, and that school is one of the hottest schools. They're going down to 5A. This job is one of the hottest jobs in the area, right? Well, this article published the list of all 43 persons who applied for the job, who made the cut, the initial cut. 43 applicants made the cut. He published all 43 of their names. Now, mind you, this football, they're out of football season, so it's not the same, not exactly the same duplicated example. But it does, my point is, that means those 43 that made the cut, their names are published in the newspaper in Beaumont today, right? So that means it's going to get back to some of those parents or some of those principals or some of those athletic directors. Then what? So is the energy the same? Remember I'm saying? Because Jorge Ramos, you know, now I do understand. Here's how this stuff goes. Normally, if you got relationships with guys, you're gonna take care, and that's what relationships are for. You try to take care of those who take care of you, and that's just part of life. Not necessarily media, not necessarily sports, but in life, you normally support those who support you. Normally, you would think that, and so that was one of the reasons why. I didn't publish the names of the coaches. Actually, I amended my article and only published the school districts to help protect some of those coaches. Because at first I published some of the schools when I came out with the article. But I was letting you know, in media, this stuff is common. Now, if you went for the interview and we're talking, you say, man, keep that under wraps. Many of you guys know. You give me some news, you tell me to keep it under the wraps, I'm going to keep it up under the wraps. But if I got to find out on my own, you can't dictate if I find out on my own. It just don't work like that. And that's part of the understanding that I want to apply to some of you guys. Just wanted to get that out there and explain to you how, you know, it's okay now. I don't hear no backlash when old Jorge released all 43 of them names. But then, you know, oh, man, you killing me on this. But anyway,
I got a question,
Of that Jordan High School job, I could give you guys some news today, but I'll wait. I'll hold this nugget.
Yeah, hold it.
I'll hold it until after the regular season ends as to who will get that job. Because if I put it out there right now, I already know KDISD. They'll take it from the guy who they just gave it to. They'll take it from him just out of spite, and he'll lose a job, just like the other article made the other guy pull out the job. But that's what media do. When people would do that, they don't want you to beat them with their own news. But I can tell you guys something. There's a lot of scoop I can break out there if I want to play hound dog. A whole lot within certain school districts that I can break out there. So a lot of people ought to chalk it up and just be cool with it and just say, you know what? He showed right, man. Let's let Hicks be on that. It's a lot. You know, for example, when I know a kid is getting ready to go and transfer to another school or maybe going to a certain school or checking out a certain school, if I put it out there, you know what that does? That's a warning shot to the administrators to let them know, or to the school district, or to let them know what could happen. I could do it on almost every weekly occasion.
Well, I got a question. I got a question. Yeah. What advice would you give seniors? You can brief, make it brief. Seniors who don't have an offer yet. Guys that are marginal and might not get an offer. What advice do you have? I'm not even on the screen. Ain't that something? What advice do you have for them? You know, what advice would you have for these guys? I mean, it's just some lot of guys, they're playing on pretty good teams. And, you know, some of them think they should be getting an offer somewhere, and they're not. this boy, Marcus Sloan, said get an internship. Man, something wrong with this man, man. Something wrong with it. What advice, Jim? I mean, I know you got some events coming up, unsigned senior events coming up. What advice, I mean practical advice. I'm not talking about philosophical stuff. Just practical stuff that we can just say, look here, young fella, if you don't have an offer, if you ain't got them coaches coming into your gym on your athletic period, what, and you think you good enough, and it ain't happened for them, and everybody think it's everybody else's fault, Jimmy, why they ain't got it. He didn't do this. He didn't know. Let me show you something I learned from the college coaches, Jimmy. But then you can add it. Dude, if we'd have seen you all summer, he just told me now, parents, y'all got to understand, I'm not Jimmy. I'm trying to chisel away at Jimmy. But these are facts. I'm telling you, they told me this. And then what they said, Robert, I want you to educate and keep talking to these parents. If you've been playing an AAU and live events, running your butt around here, wasting my money all this time, and you're a senior, and no one has came to your activity period, offered you, what the hell? And they think they good enough because their mamas and daddies think they good enough. Let me repeat that. Their mamas and daddies think they good enough, but their mamas and dads ain't college coaches. Neither am I. Because if it was up to me, I put all of them on the team. Especially the ones that the schools that I like. But when them coach, see what Jimmy, I found out from the coach, he said, you label a guy this way, Robert. You told me he can do this. When I get to the game, he can't do none of that. Then I saw him this summer. He ain't did none of that. I need players. Listen to me, mamas and dad. He say he in the business of getting players. But Jimmy, what does little Johnny has to do? Did he need to go out, run out, and shoot up all the No, hell no. Because guess what? Now you're doing something you know you can't do. Because you ain't going to finna come here and do all that. Let's get that straight. You're not. It's the McDonald's All-Americans haven't done that, sir. So, Jimmy, I put some more on it, but the moral is, it's some parents out there, dude, this season almost over, man. And they're desperate. And they think little Johnny good enough. What could they do?
Well, one thing you have to understand, coaches aren't in your gyms, in your open gyms as much right now because these coaches, some of these same very college coaches, are in the midst of their season trying to make the play postseason as you should be doing at your high school.
Yeah, I'm talking all year. I'm talking about all year, Jim.
You talking about all year?
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm talking about ain't nobody been in there all year.
Well, ain't nobody been there all year, and that's when, as a player, it's kind of, as a parent, put it like this, because parents, kids, you know, they should be in class right now. Mm-hmm. But as the parent, you have to really assess what's taking, what his ability. Look at the resume. It's all you have to go on right now. What is he doing with his high school? Now, if he hadn't been on there all year, what is he doing on his team right now? Is he in good standing with the coach? Because a high school coach, for the kid who has no recruitment, that high school coach will get a could possibly get a call for somebody to, as a reference check. Most college coaches will call the high school coach. Now, part two, if I strongly encourage those who don't have the office, first of all, if you are ranked by anybody on any service, that goes in your basketball resume. You put together your basketball, your hoop resume. In your hoop resume, it would probably have a link to a quarter of a game, electronic link to whatever account you have. Some of you guys, you know, may want to go for a mixtape. That's what you want to do. Your accomplishments on the court, individual accomplishments, team accomplishments, outside community service projects that you've involved yourself in, list those and your academic resume as well. Meaning that your core GPA, your ACT or SAT score, college entrance exam score, and also you list about 3 to 5 references. That's your hoop resume. And of course, in the first, you let them know if you're ranked in something, you put your rankings in there. That means something to some people. Remember, for those who say rankings don't matter, then guess what? That's their belief. You know? But it matters to some college coaches, because in that way now, if they get that thing and you're ranked number 24, 34 in a city like Greater Houston or DFW, that carries weight. They're going to say, oh, wait a minute. If he's 6'7", he's ranked 34, let me go look. Let me see. We need a wing or 4 or 5.
What is he, 5'11", but we list him at 6 foot? How can I need some 5'11s to get – I got a couple of 5'11s I need to play in college next year. How can I help him?
Those 5'11s, the thing is how you look at this, even I mentioned ranking a while ago, even let's say that 5'11 is ranked somewhere. Those college coaches aren't recruiting off of that ranking list alone. They're recruiting, you are being recruited in the same pot with every kid from every state in the, at least in the 48 connected states. At least of those. So people, and you're being recruited against transfers. So if the coaches know that there's a possibility they can get a transfer, an older kid who they don't have to worry about, who understands what it means when they say wake up for a 5:30 workout, they know to be there, they're going to go for the older kid. So what you can do in that situation, and I mentioned last week, we had that coach on the chops where he was in the boom boom room. Schools like community colleges in Houston, they have the Lone Star College Network.
I'm talking the boom room. They're brutal. Keep going.
They have club teams. So if a young person still wants to go and go through the rigors, he can go there. That's like a JUCO, but it's a 4-year school. Well, I'm sorry, it's a JUCO. Those are community colleges, Lone Star College. I think, if I'm not mistaken, you guys can correct me on that. But you can go and play there. If you are a qualifier, and those teams play against colleges. They play against junior colleges, and they play against 4-year club team, intramural teams. Well, guess what? That young man is still keeping his hoop dream alive while getting a college education. You want your kid to play. If you just want him to be a part of a program, that's a whole different thing. I don't honestly believe that a lot of the people that I know that are ranked really would accept knowing going in You can come and be a part of this program. You won't never touch the court unless we up or down by 40. I don't think many would take that. And that's the part where it creates. And what happens
is, does winning separate them? If they're on a team, if they won, would that help them?
That helps because especially if they're a guard.
Yeah.
Because a lot of college coaches say that they want somebody that understands how to win. It helps. It's like tied, you know, if it's two guys and it's tied, hell, and they were tight, the guy that's winning is in first place gonna get that spot over the guy that's in last place. If they're relatively equal in talent, I'm gonna go with the guy with the winning DNA. But the thing is, a lot of people, far too many, are grown folk. You're allowing these kids to go into situations that where it's almost like a kamikaze mission for them to even get into a uniform at this college. And then when they don't, when the reality set in, they don't even want to go to school no more. That's the part that's hurting our society.
But Jimmy, I don't mind them not going to school if they got to put themselves in this student loan debt. So I would advise them to be a little, well, it's too late now. Let's talk to the ninth graders. I advise you to get your grade level up so you can have assistance. Because like I told y'all months ago, I was sitting there and my son called me. All his partners was at the, they was up there talking, and some of the guys were talking about how they paying $700 and $800 a month on student loans, and he don't have to pay none of it. You know what I'm saying? Reality woke up to him because he was just, you follow me? He had to call me and say, "Dad, man, thank you, man." Because these guys are paying $700 and $800. That's why these guys can't move in certain neighborhoods like he moved in. Because they was just sitting there talking, "Dude, you got $700 or $800. That's just above everything else you got." And so that's why I always stress, I said it years back, that education is the new form of currency in the 20th century. I haven't said it in a long time, maybe. It's the new form of currency. We can now, in America, make money on our brain, our intellectual property. You remember, you work at the Ford plant, you work at the Chevrolet plant, you work at the coal plant, you work at the plants in Ohio, the tie. Boy, you can make a comfortable living for your family. But it's been a paradigm shift. Now you can make money with your mind. Uber came out of somebody's mind. I mean, a Snapchat, all these things came out of somebody's mind. That's why I said, Trey, I remember the little kid. You remember the little kid that told me, "Mr. Hatter, I don't want to play basketball no more. I have too many problems with my dad. Too much. Man, I just want to go." Listen to this, y'all. To aviation school. Let me rewind that and press play. I visited the school with my mama. I want to be a big 6'8", 6'5". I want to work on planes. I see you. I love the game. I just don't like what comes with it. Parents. Don't be a menace in society. Well, don't be a menace with Keenan. He said, what he said? Teaching moment every time. Yeah. Well, he said something crazy. Teaching moment, parents. Man, you can't put this kind of pressure on Junebug. Put pressure on him in the classroom. I promise you that's what I did. Homeboy, you a midget. Ask him. I hope he watched the show. You're a midget. Y'all are dime a dozen, baby. You can shoot. You can dribble. You can pass. You can do all that. You can dunk. But guess what? A whole lot of dudes look like you. But Jimmy, I just got a group text, right?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, check this out. Group text. This is what I like, y'all. Mamas and daddies, I'm trying. I just had my annual review. Got another exceeding performance. I exceeded my performance for the third year in a row. And he's only been there at this company for 3 years. It's almost unheard of in the environment he in. And he just group texts me, his mom, his grandma's, his uncle. Y'all, when I tell y'all stuff like that, it ain't for me to talk about him. I know he gonna be good. It's for me to know, for y'all to know, my son thought he was going to the league too. Let me repeat that. He thought. Not me. He thought. Guess what? He had a chance. We made all everything. I sent stuff back to Jimmy. Dean the record books at Cornell. But he kept getting hurt. Every year. Andrew. Jimmy, how you doing, man? Can't make at the what conference play? Hurt. Freshman year. Second year. Conference play. Hurt. Third year, conference play hurt. Fourth year, conference play hurt. So he would kill everybody in non-conference. Every time, that's why he never made all-conference team, because he never played a full conference slate. But guess what I looked at him, parents? I looked at him, and when he was younger, Bobby Benjamin, Stephen Woods, I asked him a question. I said, man, we got to go work out because it's important. You got a big game. You finna go to EYBL. Get what he told me. No, not EYBL. I got to go for the playoffs or something, whatever. You know what he told me? Man, I got to study for this test. So his habits, I knew his habits didn't line up. Because Kevin Durant would have went to the gym. Kyrie Irving would have went to the gym. Bryce Griggs would have went to the gym. I understood, parents, what I had as a son. Yeah, it broke my heart a little bit. All this time and money and stuff out and put Jimmy. Come on, man. I sponsored a whole team. Flying around everywhere. In nice everything. For 2 years. Go add that up. But guess what? I prepared him to think like that. That's why I couldn't get mad at him. So that parent, telling you, I know we got to put that basketball in his hand. I loved it. But boy, that boy had a basketball, Jimmy, in one hand. And Jimmy, and a book in the other one. I promise you. So if I do nothing else, I hope I inspire you. You know, forget them clowns like Marcus Cason on there messing with me on here. This is very serious business. This ain't nothing. I know why God put me in this place. I would have never thought I'd be on a radio show or hosting a sports talk show ever in life. Thank you, Chris Walker. Y'all should be thanking Chris Walker. But that's what's going on, man. I mean, and Jimmy and we tried. That's why, hey, look, Jimmy, you know what I told a kid the other day? I might not know all the answers, but I'm going to get you to the guy who got the answers. Because guess what, Jimmy? I don't want to just be right. I want you to have the right information. Let me repeat that. That's tweetable right there. Jimmy, I don't want to just be right. just telling you something that I know that's right. I'm getting you to the professional. A guy been doing this for 19 years. And me, I'm going to disagree with him. Guess what? On professional sports. Because I've been doing that for 30 years. But in high school sports, here you go, sir. Here you go, sir. That's what you do. Because I've seen what he done behind the scenes. I know. Hey, he just said he petty. He gonna get mad at you if you don't. He already told you. He don't play. Yeah. If you don't want to be on the cover of the magazine and all that kind of stuff, try to do all that stuff, you got a life sentence. I'm telling you. Yeah, it's got a life sentence. But I see him behind the scenes saying, man, I got to get this boy. I got to figure out a way to get this kid a scholarship. I don't know how. I got to figure out he's talented enough. I got to figure out the right fit. It's unbelievable, man. I mean, this is a disadvantage that y'all have, that you're talking to a guy that traveled all over the world that no one else has. At the beginning of next month, I'm going overseas. I'm finna take this joint overseas. And all them folk gonna be saying, what? Speaking of all these crazy ass like Jimmy, I'm learning a couple of new languages. We taking this thing overseas. They gonna be over there talking about top. They gonna be over there talking about the chop shop. So it's a unique opportunity, man. I just, you know, thank God for you, Jimmy. I know people don't understand. Me and you gonna go edit, but as soon as this show over, we call each other. That's what y'all don't understand. This show got to be contentious. If I sit up there, yes, Jimmy, you're right. Yeah, Jimmy, yes, you're right. Y'all gonna look at me like, man, get the hell out of here. I gotta give you another way to look at it. Because he's gonna always get, that man told me something the other day. I ain't never heard him say. The man told me he was a half breed. I said, and I didn't even, look, y'all notice, I didn't say nothing. I guess all of us like a half breed, because I know my African brothers didn't look like this, because I've been over there. So I guess all of us got something in us. But we live and we learn. And man, hey, Jimmy, hey, don't ever stop doing, you know how them people talking about, that's why I gave Mayor Andrew Young his flowers. We all should give, man, a Sloan, all of you guys, Doug, I see the stuff y'all doing. Parents, I just asked the high school basketball guru. I ain't got no son. And the two nephews I got, they college is secured. All I'm asking this for the people who I don't know. It's going to benefit even the kids, since y'all think I don't like certain schools, even the kids at Shadow Creek and every other school in this city. Jimmy is going to help. All of us, we're going to help. But you, hey, parents, you got to be good enough, baby. Got to be good enough. What you got, Jimmy?
Yeah, gotta be good. That's a great, great, great speech. You giving it to him on Baby Friday.
I'm sorry,
and of
man.
Course, hope you guys are taking heed and taking notes. And I want to leave you guys with one last drop on a compound and add to this. And the Unsigned Senior Showcase, which we do every year, is in conjunction with the Spring Icebreaker. It goes on, actually, it's part of the Spring Icebreaker. And that's on March the 20th and the 21st. So it'll be that evening of the 20th, which is a school day. Because some coaches only can come in one day. Some coaches can only come in the second day. So therefore, we're going to start that evening on March the 20th and going to conclude on the 21st. Alex Pugh, he's on the feed. He's been running, helping to facilitate. He's a high school coach, and a lot of you guys didn't know that. He's a high school coach over in the Aldina Independent School District. And he's going to help. I mean, understand, I can get anybody to facilitate this thing pretty much.
Yeah.
But if a person wants to do it, so he loves doing it because it helps pencil sharpen with a lot of these kids he saw come through the ranks over the past 2 or 3, 4 years. Now they don't have it. But the thing is, this Unsigned Scene Showcase ain't for everybody.
Okay.
See, that's the key.
Okay. Okay.
That's why you don't see it advertised.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
Because right now, it's kind of like it's a reason why. If I say the rankings, people want some of you people to believe that the rankings don't mean much. Well, guess what they do mean much for? They mean for this event. Because if you are not ranked as a 12th grader right now in the Greater Houston area, then you have to wait. Because invites will go out to all unsigned seniors.
Okay.
Either verbally first, if they don't reply, then guess what? Move on.
Because
guess what?
That's good.
It's going to be a lot of them. And the way we do it, their summer teams, they play, because a lot of these guys will be playing in the spring icebreaker as well. So that means we make it where the schedule that team they play with, the coaches will be at the unsigned senior event. There are two different things while people are playing. While it's a different whole objective for an 11th grader, a 10th grader, and a 9th grader versus a 12th grader that's playing some grassroots basketball.
Okay.
A whole different objective.
Okay.
The 12th grader, that's when the ranking don't matter no more. Once you get on that court, that coach don't matter. You're an unsigned senior. You're lumped together now. Now you're trying to fight. You're playing for a free education.
Yeah.
Thank you. And this is a platform that we put together for you guys to be able to showcase your talent and draw and attract the attention of just one college coach.
All we need. Now,
there will be a couple dozen college coaches there. It will be that. That's every year.
Jimmy, you can't go to but one college anyway.
That's what they don't realize. And at that point, see, what happens is, even when the Unsigned Senior Showcase, here's what happens. You got followers and you have leaders. Mm-hmm. Parents, relatives, you can't afford to allow your son to continue to be a follower at this junction of his career. Follower means just because my homeboy going to that college and we both the same size, he going to try to walk on. I'm going to go there and try to walk on too. One of y'all ass ain't going to make it. Well, I'm going to send him over there. I'm going to go with my girl. Right now, parents, uncles, cousins, it's time for you guys to step in and be proactive, because people will nonchalantly act like they don't need to play in this unsigned senior event when this is the only one that they'll be able to play in. Well, I'm sorry. This is one of the only ones where they'll be able to play in where they can sleep in their own bed and won't have to pay no more than $60-$70 to play in.
Awesome.
Think about it. You're going whenever you
finish, leave me a couple of minutes, because Jeremy wanted me to talk about that topic that I've been telling him all week. So just leave me a couple of minutes. See what we got. You got anything to say?
That's pretty much in the nutshell on that. And lastly, I'm gonna take it to the 4 minute. You say leave you. I'm gonna take it to the 4 minute mark.
Okay. Adam. All right.
Here's what I want you guys to soak on over the weekend.
Okay.
You mentioned earlier that, of course, part of my I'm one of them guys that's gonna admit to you, and I know from being in the room with a lot of these other guys. And I know from talking to a lot of these other guys, they apply it, and you know they apply it. They just won't tell you publicly. If put it like this, if Dino's Tragonis is doing his Pangos Junior camp, satellite camp that goes, they have different around the country, and he comes into Texas, and you're in the 10th grade, and you don't come to that, yet you want an invite to Pangos camp. What do you think Dino is going to do? Your ass out. Because he's going to say, you should have came to my camp. So he ain't going to give you favor after he came to your city or your state and you didn't play. If there's a Great American Shootout, they got the Gasols and your team is not a sneaker team. Because the sneaker team have different obligations during the live periods. They have to be in other cities. But you ain't a sneaker team. And you elect to go and play in another event when those rankings come out, unless you are ripping it off the chart, you think TexasHoops.com is going to give your kid favor? Knowing that you made a conscious decision to play over there. So that's all I'm going to leave you guys with. So why in the hell, you understand that about them, you think that I'm going to sit there and turn the other cheek if you go somewhere else and you're not playing in my where I'm going to be at? Then that's, I'm not going to hurt you. I'm just going to help the next guy that's compatible. First, if he's showing up. That's just all. I'm not going to hurt a kid because the kid didn't make the decision. But at the same time, I'm going to help the next one that is, if y'all are close. Now, if it ain't close, I got to go with that one. Hey, got to do it. But you, choices and consequences. Remember that. I'm toss it back to you, Adam.
You know what's so unique, Jimmy? I like to read, right? I saw this book called Bad Sports, How Owners Are Ruining the Game We Love. Okay? Then the same author who wrote that book, he wrote an article, and his name is Dave Ziering, happened to be a white guy. He wrote an article called Why aren't there so few black coaches in the NFL? Then he said, it's the racism, stupid. That's the title of the article. Dave Ziering, Z-I-R-I-N. So, Jimmy, thought about something, right? You know, Super Bowl has passed. You know, y'all done took your, ate your chips and salsa. You went to a Super Bowl party and all that. But reading this book, and knowing what I know, being in this business for 30 years, I'm just finna be frank with y'all. NFL is a bastion for racism. Everything from the teams whose couple of them's name, who one of them's name is a racial slur, the one in Washington, in case you didn't know. The reality that even 70% of the players are black, and only 3 of them are head coaches. I'm going somewhere with this, y'all. Only one black, right before the Super Bowl, it wasn't but one black person as a GM. And now Cleveland just hired Andrew Berry. So we got 2 GMs. They attack Kaepernick or any other player who stand up against racism and for building a new equitable society. Many of their owners are billionaires, and they back who? Jimmy? Donald Trump. And view the players as meat to profit from. Yeah, this coming out of Robert Hatter's mouth. Yeah. I know y'all thought. Anthony Weston, you never thought it'd come out of my mouth. Because I had to make sure I got this, all this information. We don't think about this often in a sense, Jimmy. The kind of racism that exists, who the owners are, their relationships with the players. Why should that matter to the people, Jimmy, that just want to watch the game? Why should that matter? Because there's some guy, man, I don't want to hear that. I just want to watch the game. It only matters to you. You watch sports. If you watch sports as a conscious fan, some fans just watch sports. But if you're a conscious fan, you're always in a rage. It only matters if we want to see the game that's taking place beyond the game. Jimmy, you know, I always tell these players, y'all got to play the game behind the game or the game other than the game. Don't just play the game on the field, sir. Just play the game, you know, beyond the game. So, Jimmy. If it only matters if we want to understand at the end, what the NFL truly is, behind Jimmy, that carefully manicured shield, it only matters if we know that there are NFL players, check this out, who said that the NFL, Jimmy, listen to me. Y'all hear this. NFL players who told me out of their mouth NFL stands for not for long and N-word for lease. That's what they say. Not for long and N-word for lease. That's how they think. I had several players say that to me. Because, Jimmy, the owners just believe the players are just a piece of equipment. The average NFL career is only 3.5 years, Jimmy. Everybody don't play long like Tom Brady, Emmitt Smith. 3.5 years, Jimmy. Michael Bennett from Houston, Texas, A. Lee Taylor High School. He once said, people think the NFL is integrated. But it's not integrated. It's actually segregated. Segregated before the for the people who play and the people who don't. Segregated from the people who sit in the front office and those who sit in the owner's box. Jimmy, I told you when I go to Super Bowl, what I tell you, I don't never get the players' tickets. I never ask for the players' tickets. You know why? Because the players' tickets are way up there. Especially if you ain't in the game. Your tickets, your mom and them sitting up in the 600 section. But if you get them from the owner, boy, you're right down there. You're right down there. And he just said, and that kind of segregation is something that you should be well aware of. I'm just helping y'all. Because a lot of y'all football fans. Because if the NFL is going to be a cultural force in our society, which it surely is, then we should be able to make demands on it. Anthony Weston, I've been listening to you. Jimmy, if they are a cultural force in our society, we should be able to put demands on it and to be equitable and, frankly, to be less authoritarian. Roger Goodell, whatever you say. Come on, man. Come on. For years, Jim, people have been trying to get the Washington, I don't even call that name, the Washington owner to change the name of his team. You familiar with that, right? He won't do it. Jimmy. I dealt with him before, Jimmy. He won't even consider it. Dan Snyder is his name. The things that happened to Colin Kaepernick, all the things that have gone on in the NFL, and I'm almost through. There is only one team that isn't owned by a billionaire. And y'all know who that is. Green Bay. It's owned by the fans. It's a publicly traded company. So my question is to y'all, how do you change that? This is like a private domain. This is like these owners' plantation. How do you change it? Jimmy, ain't nobody coming there changing our CS Sports. You ain't going to let them do it. It's true. I'm going to tell you how. Tell you how you can do it. Tell you how you can do it. It's through the Players Association and the union. We got to get better leadership because these players got more power. I'm telling you how we got to change. Tell you something else we got. Because their contract is coming up, Jimmy, next year. This is a big deal. And guess what? All of the fans who like football, y'all should follow these contract negotiations very closely. Very closely. They should, Jimmy, they should contain demands. I didn't say requests, Jimmy. They should contain demands about a pipeline toward coaching. A pipeline towards working in the front office for the players. Jimmy, it should contain some sort of stipulation in the collective bargaining agreement, not that Rooney Rule stuff, that make sure that the players have proper health care after retirement, like they do in the NBA. So they just not seem like pieces of meat from the owners. Give me my 3.5 years. I'll see you later, boss. I think that's the only way, ladies and gentlemen, that we are going to make a dent in this. Now, for fans, the fans, y'all can make demands as well. I got some for y'all. Anthony Weston. Certainly for the hiring better coaches, which means black coaches, because they get shut out of the hiring process, Jimmy, despite of what we call the Rooney Rule. Jimmy, this forces the Rooney Rule, right? Where did I go? Hold on. That forces ownership to sit across the table with candidates of color. That's all the Rooney Rule says. He had to sit across the table. You remember, Jerry Jones, Marv Lewis was one of the candidates. He slept across the table. Wait a minute. He sat across the table, but Mike McCartney did what, Jimmy? Slept in the house. You follow me? We need to look to the union. Fans need to be more conscious about it, and we need to be able to discuss this in uncomfortable spaces like where? Sports radio. That's why I'm talking about it today. I know some people out there, this is uncomfortable too. I love you. I love you. And we need to discuss this on social media and make sure that this discussion is not whitewashed out of the conversation. It is only the last several years, Jimmy, that you have seen a lot of black quarterbacks. Jimmy Hicks, that was a white position in football. Some of those owners of those teams really did not think much of the intelligence of a people of color, black people. We have to go with what they show us, you know, in practice. When there is only one front office leader, now it's two, who is an African-American, and one is in Miami, and not coincidentally, Jimmy, he got a black coach that he hired. Cleveland, like I said, hired Andrew Byrd. That should tell us something about how Anthony Weston, how the system operates, how institutional racist the NFL is. I know these words ain't never came out of my mouth. I had to study. 70% of the players are black. Only 3% of the coaches are black. I'm not even speaking. What if you're not a player, Jimmy? What if you mean Alex Pugh, Jimmy Hicks, Anthony Weston, Michael Anderson, let me call it by name, B. Scott, Todd Holmes. What if we all? What if we're not a player? You are just as incredibly intelligent black person who knows a lot about football just like everybody else. But you see that among white coaches all the time, particularly white coaches who are part of a family tree of certain coaches. Jimmy, the Super Bowl attending, losing San Francisco 49ers, who was coached in the Super Bowl, is the Kyle Shanahan is the son of longtime Bronco coach Mike Shanahan of the Denver Broncos. Neither Mike, Jimmy, nor Kyle played in NFL. But there you have a nepotism pipeline, which exists on a host of a lot of fronts throughout the NFL. That's why every time y'all hear me, I go and look and see who's in there. Jimmy, you remember I always go and see who's in the front office when I see a team? I always do this. I've been doing research. If you're a black player and you can't make it to a coaching position, what the heck are the chances that you think that Todd Holmes, a black person who is deeply intelligent and intelligent about coaching and NFL strategy, Todd Holmes, Anthony Weston, Michael Anderson, you don't have a chance. You basically have to have no chance to make it to the higher echelon in the sport. And that's really, really problematic on a grand scale of things. But y'all, I got more about that one, but I know it's overtime, and I'm going to find out where I stopped, but I got more. And how fans, you're very important. You got to put demands on your team. You got to go on social media. Colin Kaepernick is a black eye in NFL, which Jimmy, which they had never had. They never let nobody on the network mention him. And that's the last time they went to the Super Bowl. But guess what? I'm going to leave y'all there because I got to go. But let me tell you something. I'm going to continue this NFL. Go get that book. Great book by David Azarian. And read some of his articles. Unique, man. Unique being a fan. And Jimmy, I'm telling you. I haven't watched a whole NFL game in a long time. Because, you know, I really don't. But, Jimmy, I know one thing I haven't did and I had, you know, power to do. Jimmy, I've never bought paraphernalia. I don't have a T-shirt. I don't have a team emblem. I don't have a team watch. I don't have a team nothing. I don't have I don't have nothing. I don't have only NFL stuff that I got in my house or the signed memorabilia from my players who sent it to me. I don't go in that. See, y'all, that's how when you show up with the shirt on, boy, you done paid. So that's the power you have. Don't just sit up here and say, I'm not going to watch it. Boy, it's a lot of stuff we can do. But Jimmy, I'm gonna let you, I'm gonna let you take it out because we need to hear this on Chop Show, on talk shows around the world. And what better place to start it right here on the Chop Shop? What you got,
man? I know what I got. I mean, I got to get on up out of
here.
Let's
go,
you guys. It's the weekend. We didn't get a chance to talk about the NBA All Star. That's gonna be this weekend. You got the celebrity game on Friday, the All Star and the Skills Challenge on Saturday, right. And the game will be on Sunday. But what we will do is recap it and of course especially that highly anticipated tribute to Kobe Bryant will take place this weekend. So once again, guys, you take it easy this weekend. You guys be careful out there.
Yes.
Hopefully, a lot of the stuff we gave will be on those streets. Make sure if you're driving anywhere near the Galleria on I-10 East, check your GPS apps, because freeways will be closed going depending on what direction you're going. In Galleria area, 610 and 59, and of course I-10 and Waco, that bridge is being replaced. So other than that, you guys take it easy. Get out there and support some high school basketball. Go over to rcssports.com and get your daily fix as well as your district standings. I see you guys. Don't forget, we have the middle school city championships. The schedule will be released tomorrow. It will be released tomorrow, Valentine's Day, on rcssports.com.
What's going to be released?
Tomorrow, Valentine's
Day. What's going to be released, though?
The middle school championship, the city championship schedule. Those are the champions from various school districts around the area.
Okay.
Once again, it's only for people that's champions, first or second place in their respective districts. And a lot of those teams will be vying for the title of the 2020 city champion, as well as $500 were given to the winners of the 8th grade and the 7th grade divisions, respectively.
What?
That event will be held at Booker T. Washington High School on Saturday and Sunday, not this weekend, but February the 22nd and 23rd. Make sure admission is only $5. Remember, we're not trying to hit you upside the head, trying to have a very economical and affordable event. where people can come out, watch their kinfolk, and actually see some of the stars of tomorrow in action. And also want to give a shout out. Chris Walker has stepped up to the plate. He's given $500 to one student athlete who will be participating in this event. You don't have to win this event, but you have to win the essay writing contest that will be pertaining to Black history, and it must be from the year 1970 or before. Nothing after the year 1970. More details on that will be forthcoming on next week. Or you guys can reach out and watch the talk.
So the middle schoolers got to write an essay.
One winner, here's the deal. You get $500 scholarship he's granting, plus that person who wins can increase that scholarship by $500 each year he's in high school. As long as they maintain an A average. So if you maintain an A average, you can turn that $500 into $2,500.
Jim, you said scholarship. So you got to wait till these kids get out of college?
No. Okay. He's going to give the $500.
Okay.
You're getting that whoever wins the essay writing contest.
Okay.
These are A graders. Okay. For the eighth grade class, right? Mm-hmm. Now, when they get to high school in the ninth grade next year.
Okay.
So that means that money rolls over.
They got a chance to double down.
So that money won't go directly to the hands of the kid. It will go directly once that kid enrolls in college. That scholarship is going to be $500, anywhere from $500 to $2,000. That amount, it will be deposited into his student account once that person arrives in the college.
Awesome.
Checks.
Get Chris.
So that means you can't spend it.
Yeah, give him enough chance.
That means you can't Foot Locker with that money.
I get Chris enough time to say that the money up. That's good.
That's what it does.
$500 a year. We can handle that. That's good. So that's awesome. Chop shop.
Anyway, guys, you make sure you spread the word, and we have more details. But once again, you guys, thank you so much for tuning to the Chop Shop. Make sure you share the show if you hadn't done so. But we're in overtime. I got to get up out of here. It's time to slide on down Dino's back and yabba dabba do this thing. You guys watch cartoons. You know just what I'm talking about. That's it. On behalf of Ray and Claude, we up out of here. This is the Boom Boom Room. See you guys. Thanks so much. But guess what? Chop.
Jim Hicks. Rob Hatter. You are now tuned in to the Chop Shop. I'm Retro. Let's get it. We in the chop shop, we live in the chop shop. We talking sports talk, we live in the chop shop. We in the chop shop.